Today we are discussing something a bit more exotic, and that is dark matter. I personally spent the last year researching this topic, so I'm quite familiar with it. If you're interested in physics, you have probably come across this term at some point. Many people might, however, not know what exactly dark matter is, or what the dark matter discussion is about, and this we will rectify in this video. Before we get any further, let me just state that dark matter is not the same as dark energy. Dark matter has its roots in astrophysics and cosmology, and we have much to learn as the underlying nature of dark matter still remains unknown. The problem can be traced back to 1933 when Swiss astronomer Fritz Zwicky studied the Coma galaxy cluster. What he found would prove to be the beginning of a serious headache for many physicists. What Zwicky found was that if he looked at the different velocities of the galaxies in the cluster, then the relative velocity was too high for the cluster to be stable. Thus, in other words, gravity would not be strong enough to keep the galaxies together in the cluster, and the galaxies would fly away from each other. As it turns out, the same issue exists inside galaxies, thus the stars and galaxies also move too fast. Recall these plots with velocity and distance rotation curves. If we consider usual Newtonian gravity, we would find the following relationship between velocity and orbiting radius in a galaxy. V squared divided by r is equal to g times m over r squared, where g is the gravitational constant, m is the mass, r is the radius, and v is the velocity. From this, we find that the velocity as a function of the radius from the center is proportional to v as a function of r is proportional to r to the power of 1 minus x divided by 2, where x is some constant. If we use this rule and compare it to observed rotation curves, we find that the velocity is simply too high. This posed the question, what is wrong? The original publication didn't pick up much attention in the general physics community, and the Second World War didn't do much in promoting this issue. However, in the 1960s and 1970s, more studies were done and the evidence began piling up. Something was wrong, but what exactly? Today, astrophysicists have found even more evidence for it, and it is thought to play a role in many other things than just making sure the galaxies and stars move in the correct way. If dark matter isn't a thing, then a lot of cosmology is in deep trouble. The problem is, however, that the word dark matter is misleading. The word dark matter is a historical one because initially it was a problem of missing mass. Scientists like Zwicky proposed that the solution was simply that more normal matter existed in galaxies than what we could account for. If you add more matter, then you have more mass, and more mass means more gravity, and voila, you have enough gravity to make sure the galaxies and galaxy clusters won't fall apart. Back in the 1930s, we had only discovered very few of the fundamental particles. Therefore, it was reasonable to assume that we probably had yet to discover this new dark matter. Now, here we are 90 years later, and we still didn't discover it. The word dark matter is misleading because it assumes that the solution to this missing mass problem is from dark matter. This could very well be the correct solution, but in principle you could also modify gravity or Newton's laws. This is called modified Newtonian mechanics, or MOND. If you assume that gravity or the law of inertia actually isn't exactly the same at large scales of the universe, then you could in principle also resolve the missing matter problem. Thus, the word dark matter should be more correctly considered the solution to this missing mass problem, no matter if the solution comes from discovering new particles or from modifying Newton's laws or gravity. In principle, the solution could also be to have a theory with both modifications to gravity and new particles, but that would generally add a lot of extra degrees of freedom that you would have to account for. And since the philosophy of science tells us to choose the simplest models over complicated ones, then you would need a good reason for choosing this combined model. Of course, if it turns out to be the only solution that works out, then it has to be the winner. As it looks now, basically all Mond-like theories have been excluded, and one of the great problems with Mond models is to account for the CMB. It is very hard to make a model that can reproduce the CMB without particle dark matter, and therefore many physicists expect that the solution to the missing mass problem is dark matter. While the nature of dark matter is still unknown, we nevertheless know a lot about it. Assuming that the nature of dark matter is some new particle, then we can use the Lambda CDM model to figure out how much of it exists. Using the latest CMB results, one finds that around 27% of the universe is dark matter. This is a bit more than 5 times the amount of visible matter made from the standard model of particles. So what is this dark matter? Originally, it was just thought that there is a lot of matter in the universe which is made from particles that we know, but they just form dark objects we can't see. These objects have been called MACHOs, for massive astrophysical compact halo objects. The idea is simple: you have some very large dark object in space. Because they're dark, you can't see them directly, but because they're massive heavy objects, you can see how light bent in space. This is called gravitational lensing. The problem is that while we can find some macho-like objects, for example black holes, we would expect a lot more if they were to be the source of dark matter. The solution therefore does not seem to work. This leads us to what we call non-baryonic dark matter. This category can be divided into two parts: hot dark matter and cold dark matter. Hot and cold means fast and slow. Thus, hot dark matter is just particles that move at a speed comparable to the speed of light, and cold dark matter moves much slower. Neutrinos have long been a mystery in particle physics, and it was proposed that dark matter could be fast-moving neutrinos, and thus some kind of hot dark matter. Neutrinos are very hard to detect and very light. This would explain why they would be so hard to see in space. The problem with neutrinos is that they are too light, at least the neutrinos we know. The problem is that neutrinos are fermions, and fermions obey the Pauli exclusion principle as discussed in one of my quantum mechanics videos. Because neutrinos are so light, we would need a colossal amount of them to match the expected amount of dark matter. The problem is that the Pauli exclusion principle dictates a limit to how many particles that can be in the same space, and it turns out that there simply wouldn't be space enough in galaxies to house so many neutrinos. Thus, neutrinos can only make up a small amount of dark matter. This leaves us with cold dark matter, and here the situation starts to improve. In this video, we will consider two main types of cold dark matter, namely WIMPs, weakly interacting massive particles, and axions. In this category, we consider that there exists some new undiscovered particle that is responsible for dark matter. And since the particle is unknown, it could have many different properties that we would need to figure out. The WIMP solution proposes that we have yet to discover one or more heavy particles. One of the first good candidate theories for WIMPs was supersymmetry, which predicted a lot of new particles which could act as dark matter. The problem is that we should already have discovered such supersymmetric particles by now, but we haven't seen any. There are, however, many other models that are still viable. The last thing to consider is axions, which is a rather light type of particle compared to WIMPs. This type of particle was originally proposed to resolve another big problem in physics, called the strong CB problem, which we discussed in the video about beyond the standard model. But as with the neutrino solutions, it looks rather unlikely that there could be enough axions to account for the full dark matter density. Since we still haven't discovered any particle, we remain in the dark. To summarize, dark matter should be understood as the solution to the missing mass problem and not as some particular model or particle. It is likely that dark matter has a particle nature, but we have no direct evidence yet. Dark matter is an active field of research where I'm personally involved, and there are many things to consider when trying to resolve this problem. As we've discussed, many theories have already failed, so we need to try harder to figure out this mystery. Nevertheless, I hope you learned something new and found this video interesting. If you would like to support the channel, then you can use the link in the description. You can also write in the comment section if you have any feedback or questions. As always, if you like the video, please click the like button, subscribe and share it with your friends. Stay tuned for the next video.